There's a reason that we live so far from Hollywood. In the country, looking hard to find a home. We're nothing perfect or considered, but we're so damn good. It's the story of your life. You're moving down the page, and you know you're on.
Morning, Glory America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt live inside the Beltway. On the 16th day of November in the year of our Lord, 2022, thank you for listening. Thank you for watching. If you're watching on the Salem News Channel, I'm sure our feed will get going here pretty soon. Let me begin by telling you, obviously, the lead story of the day is President Trump, former President Trump, announcing his intent to run again for the presidency last night from Mar-a-Lago. I'm sure you watched it. If you did watch it, you can call 1-800-520-1234 to tell me your comment about it. I don't want to talk to people who didn't watch it. All right, so 1-800-520-1234. I don't want to talk to rah-rah Trump people, or I hate Trump people, or never Trump people, or always Trump. I just want to talk to people who watched it and their impressions of the address. The newspapers and the news accounts are covering it significantly differently. Trump launches 2024 U.S. presidential run getting jump on rivals, is the Reuters headline. Donald Trump officially launches 2024 U.S. presidential bid, is the Financial Times headline. The Washington Post headline is Trump, who is president, fomented an insurrection, says he is running again. The twice-impeached former president has been eager to declare his candidacy, hoping to get ahead of likely rivals and potential criminal charges. And then the New York Times, Trump's announces 2024 run, repeating lies and exaggerating record. Before I go to the clips from that speech that I think are most significant, I see we're freezing up on the feed. That's too bad. Missile that hit Poland, likely launched by Ukrainian air defenses. Okay, so the missile that we worried about all day, I didn't comment on it because there was some ambiguity in the early reports, and first reports are never right, and boy, is this one wrong. The missile that hit Poland, likely launched by Ukraine in its air defense, Western officials say. Well, that's not an Article 5 crisis. It's not a commitment to go to the defense of Poland. That's not it. There's a fascinating article, though, in the New York Times, how an American survived hiding from the Russians in Kherson for 8 months. And I got to say, Timothy Morales, my hat is off to you, English teacher from America, went over there and opened an English school in Kherson. There's an interesting story behind the story here, and I haven't got time to read the whole thing, but I just find how he lived and hid out from the Russian secret police and the Russian troops is fascinating. The reactions are beginning to pour in to Donald Trump. The National Review, elections are about winning, writes Nathan Hochman. They're very anti-Trump. They're not never Trump like they were in 2016, but they're very anti-Trump. But two other stories before we get into this. And then I got to send Generalissimo a link, because Justin Trudeau and General Secretary Xi got into it at the G20. And General Secretary Xi's disdain for Justin Trudeau is barely concealed, and his attempt to dominate Justin Trudeau was successful in this clip. And you know, Xi is positioning himself to be the preeminent leader in the world, and he has taken the measure of Joe Biden, and we are in danger. We just have to get serious about China. The sooner GOP Speaker-designate Kevin McCarthy, who won going away yesterday, as did Steve Scalise. Congratulations to Tom Emmer as well. I'm disappointed that Jim Banks was not named whip, but it was a close vote. Jim Banks always gracious in defeat as he is in victory, and Tom Emmer will do a fine job. The key to me, though, is this China committee. Get it named, get it chaired, get it staffed, go out and find the Mandarin speakers, begin to have hearings on a weekly basis, two or three, make sure the C-SPAN is there, and educate the American people. I will tell you again, get TikTok off of your phone. Had another conversation last night at dinner about TikTok. It is a menace to your kids. It is a menace to their lives. It is a menace to you. In the Telegraph this morning from Great Britain, the United Kingdom, 1/5 of pupils are missing from classrooms since the pandemic. Nearly 2 million students in England are failing to attend school regularly, and study authors call rise in home education alarming. Now, I don't know if the latter is true. It depends on what it means, home education. Some people might check in a box and send their kid out to work in a in a child labor exploiting situation. That would be alarming, but homeschooling is actually preferential to many of the failed schools in the United States, as people know. And Iowa yesterday committed to following Doug Ducey's model in Arizona about money following the students. And so we are very, very important for people. We Republicans believe it is important for people to have choice, that money ought to follow the students. In Ohio, they are considering a backpack bill, which I hope they pass. In Iowa, they're going to pass one. Doug Ducey's already got it done. Florida's expanded school choice. It's the future. Also note from the Telegraph this morning, energy prices drive inflation to a 41-year high. Now let's go to what Donald Trump said last night. There are three major takeaways, in my opinion. Cut number 15. I wonder if our...
In order to make America great and glorious again, I am tonight announcing my candidacy for President of the United States.
That's the key takeaway. It took about 22 minutes to get there. Cut number 16.
It's a job for every aspiring young person and every hard-working parent, for every entrepreneur and underappreciated police officer who is ready to shout for safety in America. The police are being treated so badly. These are great people. They can straighten out the crime. They're the ones that know how to do it. We have to give them back their respect and their dignity. This will not be my campaign. This will be our campaign altogether. Because the only force strong enough to defeat the massive corruption we are up against is you, the American people.
That is the key appeal. I think one more cut. Cut 17.
The radical left Democrats have embraced an extreme ideology of government domination and control. Our approach is the opposite, one based on freedom, values, individual responsibility, and just plain common sense. It's common sense.
At one point, the former president also said, "I will be your voice." That was the appeal that he had in 2016, the forgotten man appeal. Mike Pence, who I will play a little bit more of my interview with the former vice president about his brand new book, So Help Me God, in segment three and in hour three today. But I want to get some reactions first to the president. Let's start with Gina in Houston. Good morning, Gina. What did you think of former President Trump's remarks last night?
Good morning. Well, I think that his remarks were what you would expect them to be. And I think that it resonates with his base very strongly. And I think that if he continues the way he's continuing, he very likely will get the nomination. Whether or not he wins or not is a different conversation. But I expected last night to hear everything that he said. And I wasn't surprised by anything that he said.
Were you disappointed that anything was missing?
I think there are not in terms of what he had to say last night. I think addressing mail-in ballots and that among the states, which are state issues, I don't know that last night would have been the time to address that particular issue. No, I think that he hit on domestic, tax, inflation, national security, border security. I think he hit on the infrastructure of police and so forth. I think he hit all those things that he needed to hit for when you're going to announce your run for presidency.
He did not talk about the 2020 results and what he thinks happened.
Well, that would not have been appropriate at that time, and I think that would have worked against him, and hopefully those that are advising him were strong enough to do that, and he didn't bring it up. Now, he'll more than likely bring it up as he goes along the campaign trail, but last night, that would not have been something that would have been appropriate for what he was announcing. I would have been disappointed if he went back 2 years. I don't want to hear 2 years ago. You can't win talking about 2 years ago. You can only win talking about what you're going to do in the future and giving the American people a vision that they can understand and connect to. And so long as he stays focused on that, you know, I think he'll move forward and more than likely get the nomination now.
Gina, did you vote for him twice?
Conversation.
Did you vote for him twice? Did you vote for Donald Trump twice?
It's best that I probably not publicly say one way or the other because of what my job is.
Okay. Great call. We're out of time, but great call, Gina, from Houston. More of your phone calls, 1-800-520-1234. And we'll try and get you that clip of Justin Trudeau and President General Secretary Xi at the G20. Stay tuned, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, Inside the Beltway, live on this, what is it, Wednesday? Yes, it's Wednesday. Welcome back, America. Let me begin with a market check, and then I'll get more of your phone calls. This is brought to you, of course, by Birch Gold. If you're buying gold, and boy, should you be buying gold if you're in crypto. You just move it all over before it collapses. Gold went up yesterday, 1,784, as it begins to understand the scale of the crypto collapse that is underway in the United States. I think people are going to rush to gold. If you're going to buy gold or roll over an IRA, and you're going to liquidate it, and you're going to get rid of your crypto IRA, and you're going to put it into gold, call Birch Gold. They know how to do that. Text my name, Hugh, to 989898, or simply go to hughgold.com. They'll send you the free information kit. If you're going to buy gold, buy Krugerrands or American Eagles or Canadian Maple Leafs. Do not buy collectibles. Just buy gold, and then put it in your security deposit. 5% to 10% of your net wealth should be in physical precious metals as the anchor for the bottom of your boat, the one that won't sink, the ballast to your account. Now, the cryptocurrency story. Yesterday, of course, the Dow was up 58, the S&P up 34, and the NASDAQ up 162. Gold is at 1,784, the 10-year treasury at 3.799. Now, crypto, Bitcoin, just to give you a little background here, Bitcoin is at $16,750 per coin right now. It is not without value. If you bought it a year ago when it was at $61,000 a coin, you have lost what? I don't do math. 75% of your investment, more. Okay, it's not everything. And I am beginning to think the whole shebang is going to collapse. And that's because in news items this morning, number one, those seeking a hard look at Sam Bankman-Fried, SBF, and the collapse of FTX, we'll find it in this podcast by Jason Choi. The link is in News Items by John Ellis. I've tweeted it out. Mr. Choi's, quote, definitive thread on FTX on Twitter is here and worth reading in full. The link is in the News Items newsletter that I get every morning. I highly recommend both. Cryptocurrency lender BlockFi Inc. is preparing a patent. This is number two in News Items by John Ellis this morning. Number two. Number one is about SBF and his fraud, his criminal fraud, the destruction of the wealth of thousands, maybe tens of thousands of people, destabilizing markets. The guy should be in jail in the United States. It's Bernie Madoff level fraud. And evidently in plain sight for everyone who knew anything about crypto. I don't know anything about crypto. I don't understand it. I have advised you since but it came on the air. Never buy what you can't understand. If you don't understand it, you're gambling. And if you're gambling, be prepared to lose everything you have on the table because that's what happens to gamblers. Cryptocurrency lender BlockFi. Item number two is preparing a potential bankruptcy filing after halting withdrawals of customer deposits and acknowledging that it has, quote, significant exposure to bankrupt exchange FTX. People familiar with the matter said BlockFi paused withdrawals, and limited activity on the platform last week, saying it couldn't operate business as usual given the uncertainty about FTX. BlockFi is now planning to lay off some of its workers while the troubled firm prepares for a possible Chapter 11 itself. People with familiar with the matter. Have you ever seen Mary Poppins? Have you ever seen the run on a bank? Okay, and everyone in America has seen Mary Poppins, right? Everybody. Even if you're like 5 years old, you've been allowed to watch Mary Poppins. There's a run on a bank. There's a run on crypto. And Bitcoin is holding on and saying, we're not like those people, as are other people. Coinbase, other people like that. Wow. When pillars begin to fall in Samson's temple, just look out below. If you're buying gold, HughGold.com. Michael in California, you watched the speech. What did you think about it? You have a minute, Michael.
Yes, sir. I thought it was very great. And thank you for taking my call. And I always enjoy your opinion, whether on TV or on radio. So,
thank you.
Yes, it was very inspiring. I was clapping. I was shouting. I was saying, yes, yes. Tears came to my eyes. And I said, and as I mentioned to the screener, I'm not a citizen yet, but I have applied, and I would love to be able to cast my first vote for President Donald Trump. I think he's the man of this hour again.
And what did you like the most about what he said?
I think his bravery to say that I'm going to stand up to whatever, and I'm going to fight for to make America great again. I'm going to fight for the common people. I'm going to fight for... And I love what he said about the troops that he's planning to give them their back pay, those who were let go because of COVID, because of the mandate, that they would be rehired with back pay. I hope the police that I done to
all right, Michael, we're out of time, but I appreciate the call. More of that coming up, America Plus. Some of my interview yesterday with former Vice President Mike Pence about his brand new book, So Help Me God. Stay tuned, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. On this Wednesday morning, former President Trump announced his intention to be future President Trump last night at Mar-a-Lago. I'll return to your calls on reaction to that speech after I do a couple of things. First of all, open mic moment at the G20. Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau and General Secretary Xi of the Chinese Communist Party, also President of China, have this conversation.
And that's not how the conversation was conducted. If there is
sincerity,
on your part,
free and open and frank dialogue, and that is what we will continue to have. We will continue to look to work constructively together, but there will be things we will disagree on, and you will have to continue.
Let's create the conditions first.
What then Xi says, the audio is not so great, is everything we discussed yesterday, quote, has been leaked to the papers, and that's not appropriate. That's not the way the conversation was conducted. And he walks away, dismisses Justin Trudeau, just dismisses him. Canada, and you know, Canada is a lovely place that depends upon us for its protection and on our nuclear shield, and they're a great ally. They stormed ashore at Normandy. They support our NATO. They have gotten our people out of tough spaces. They're a great ally. But Justin Trudeau is not going to go one-on-one with Xi Jinping. Not going to happen. And neither is Joe Biden. Neither is Macron. I'm not sure about Sunak yet. I haven't seen him, but we need somebody soon, because this is like the window of come on in and take everything time for Xi. Mitch McConnell is going to be challenged by Rick Scott today. Mitch McConnell is going to win. I like Rick Scott. He's been on the guest on this show. He's a friend of the program. I like Mitch McConnell. He's a guest of the show, a friend of the program. Mitch McConnell is the greatest legislative leader the Republican Party has had in my adult lifetime. Here he is yesterday, cut number one.
Well, look, I don't own this job. Anybody in the conference is certainly entitled to challenge me, and I welcome the contest.
One of the criticisms from Senator Scott and others who agree with him is that your decision not to have an agenda to run on opened up Republican candidates to attacks, that they didn't really stand for anything. What is your response to the criticism that you are partially responsible for?
Every one of our candidates knew what they were for, expressed it quite clearly. It's pretty obvious, and all of you have been writing about it, what happened. We underperformed among independents and moderates because their impression of many of the people in our party in leadership roles is that they're engulfed in chaos, negativity, excessive attacks, and it frightened independent and moderate Republican voters. And we saw that, which is why you all recall I never predicted a red wave. We never saw that in any of our polling in the states that we were counting on to win. There was no way. We had national issue set that was favorable, but as a result of our own, the perception many of them had that we were not dealing with issues in a responsible way and that we were spending too much time on negativity and attacks and chaos, they were frightened, and so they pulled back. In two states, for example, got just crushed by independent voters, Arizona and New Hampshire. So we learned some lessons about this, and I think the lesson's pretty clear. Senate races are different. Candidate quality, you recall I said in August, is important. And in most of our states, we've met that test. In a few of them, we did not.
Leader McConnell went on to say this, cut number two.
Well, as you noticed, we had a rather lengthy and fulsome discussion, not only of the election, but the way forward. And I think it's pretty obvious we may or may not be voting tomorrow. But I think the outcome is pretty clear. I want to repeat again, I have the votes. I will be elected. The only issue is whether we do it sooner or later, and I think we'll probably have another discussion about that tomorrow.
I have the votes, and I will be elected. Leader McConnell does not make statements that are untrue. He doesn't. He delivers. And so they're both men. Rick Scott, Mitch McConnell are always welcome here. Any United States senator is always welcome on the Hugh Hewitt Show. But I do believe that Leader McConnell is the best leader I have seen in my lifetime in the United States Congress for Republicans. Kevin McCarthy had a presser after his victory yesterday. Cut number three.
Well, good evening. I'm proud to announce the era of one-party Democrat rule in Washington is over. Washington now has a check and balance. The American people have a say in their government. And this new Republican leadership team is ready to get to work to put America back on the right track. It was our commitment to America that we would create an economy that is strong, a nation that is safe, a future that is built on freedom, and a government that is accountable. And that's exactly what we'll do.
Bravo for Leader McCarthy. He is the perfect man to become Speaker. He'll be behind Joe Biden, sitting next to Kamala Harris, come the State of the Union in January or February, whenever it proceeds. Yesterday, I had former Vice President Mike Pence on, and we went, it's at all of it, all 59 and a half minutes of it are at the podcast, Highly Concentrated Hugh. Go to iTunes or Spotify or the Salem Podcast Network and listen to it. It's a fascinating interview. I'm going to play for you more over the next couple of days. Here's a five-and-a-half-minute chunk that we did when we were between on-air segments that I wanted to air today. Cut number one.
I made the decision to suspend the Syrian refugee program in the state of Indiana. But my daughter, as I write in So Help Me God, had literally spent time in the Middle East. She had been to a refugee camp in Jordan and has a great heart for people in the region. And you know, it became one of those moments. She gave me permission to share in the book that we clashed. She felt very strongly that I was wrong to suspend the refugee program in the wake of that terrorist attack. I sat her down and said, as governor of Indiana, the safety and security of the people of the state was my highest priority, and I would err on the side of security until I was convinced that we were doing the kind of vetting that was necessary to ensure that no one was coming into our state that represented a threat to our people. And at the end of the day, we agreed to disagree. But you know, the thing I'm proudest of about our kids is that we raised them to think for themselves. We really did. We tried, as the Bible says, to train them up in the way they should go, and the belief that when they're old, they'll not depart from it. We taught them about our Christian faith, raised them into church, but one of the lodestars for Karen and me has always been that our kids think for themselves. We have enormous respect for them, and to this very day, we continue to be very, very close to all of our children and incredibly proud of who they are.
I love the story about attending the commissioning of your son after Officers Candidate School at Quantico. I've been there before for different people, not my kids, and I've been at an OCS for my kid, and I just think it's you just swell up. And they identified his fiance without doing so. I just thought it was a well-written. Let me go. Very well-written story. Let me go to the controversy that my caller called about earlier, the RFRA controversy in Indiana.
Sure.
It's on page 133. I have not seen you, literally not seen you, since Rick Grenell was sworn in as our ambassador to Germany with his husband, Matt, there. And you held the family Bible for Rick, and you swore. I've not seen you since that moment. And my question to you is, what do you think the Republicans ought to do about the same-sex marriage act that is going to come to the floor in the Senate today or tomorrow that Rob Portman, Susan Collins, and others are sponsoring? I would vote for it because there is no attempt to overturn Obergefell, and it does protect religious liberty. You wrote in So Help Me God, you quote Micah 4:4, everyone will sit under their own vine and under their own fig tree, and no one will make them afraid.
Right.
How does that play into what Republicans ought to vote on the new marriage act in the Senate?
Well, I'm actually glad your caller raised the issue. It was the title of that chapter in So Help Me God is Lessons Learned Defending Religious Liberty.
Yep.
Indiana enacted the Religious Freedom Restoration Act. It was immediately, almost overnight, was mischaracterized by the national media and the political left in the country as somehow a license to discriminate when in fact some 30 states at the time had Religious Freedom Acts, and President Bill Clinton had signed the federal Religious Freedom Law. It was in the days leading up to the Obergefell decision that would legalize same-sex marriage that there was a desire to ensure that people with deeply held religious beliefs that I share, that marriages between one man and one woman, would continue to be able to hold those beliefs in work and in worship and in their lives. But I tried to be candid. I tried to be humble about lessons learned along the way, because as I said once again in the book, the people of Indiana are the greatest people in the world. They're loving, they're caring, they're generous, they're strong-willed. But Hoosier hospitality is not a slogan. And we took some steps to protect constitutional liberties, but also to make it clear that Hoosiers don't believe in discrimination against anyone. I don't think anyone should ever be harassed or mistreated for who they are, who they love, or what they believe. And I think we landed there. I'll always hold the view that I have about traditional marriage, Hugh. And if I was in the Congress of the United States, I'd vote in a way consistent with my values. But, I truly do believe at the end of the day in Indiana, we squared it by simply standing on the express language of the Indiana Constitution. One of the ways I think God used that experience in my life was 6 months after that controversy in Indiana, we were able to bring the state back together by focusing on the religious liberty, the freedom of speech, and or freedom of religion and freedom of conscience that's in the Indiana Constitution. And I write about that. And it would be another half a dozen years later in another January that with that lesson enshrined in my heart, I would simply focus on what the Constitution of the United States had to say, and to stand there four square.
I'll give you more of the interview with the former vice president in hour three. It's a fabulous book. I was recommending it to people last night. It's a fabulous memoir. So help me God. Ray in Georgia. Ray, what do you think of Donald Trump's speech last night?
I listened to it. I thought it was a good speech. Did you look at him? He looked great. He looked like he lost weight. He was clear, concise. He stayed on point. He didn't mumble, go off in a weird direction. He looked great. Put a picture of him next to Joe Biden. Joe Biden looks like a corpse.
All right, but that's not, I'm just asking about the speech, not the comparison with the president. But I appreciate the call. Thank you. Time for relieffactor.com. Got to do my trundling today because it was raining yesterday, so I took the day off. And hi, Karen, curcumin, resveratrol, and omega, which, by the way, I'm pretty sure your doctor, if you've got diabetes, take those. Take those every day. Why? They help the body's natural anti-inflammatory system respond to the minor aches and pains that come with getting older or doing your exercise. And you're definitely getting older, and you should be exercising today, whether it's 10 minutes, 20, 40, 50, 100. I don't know what you do. I don't know how long you walk. I don't know what you're up to. But I want you to go out there and take your relieffactor.com. And remember, I always do it every hour to remind you, don't leave home without it. People listen for about 45 minutes a day, and I want to hit them every hour with relieffactor.com. If you're not using it, go and try it. I'll be right back. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. I think by the end of the day, we should have some calls. We don't have California's results because California's so screwed up. And boy, is Gavin Newsom getting hammered by Democrats because he did not campaign for a bunch of seats like Ken Calvert has won in Riverside County, and Gavin didn't go down to campaign forever Ken beat. And it's a few thousand votes, and they're mad. Last night, Scott Baugh's position deteriorated vis-a-vis Katie Porter. And so we really don't know. I do think the Republicans are easily at 219. The way I look at this, Mike Garcia is going to win and Kevin Kline's going to win. But Kevin Kiley is going to win. But I don't know about 220, 221, 222. And the New York Times won't budge. And that's because California hasn't reported any more results because it's a failed state. And it didn't elect Lonnie Chen. And it just didn't work. I do want to remind you that one of the issues that did not work for Republicans in Arizona was the border, as much as I thought it would. And border battle is now fully dropped. Its last episode of the six-part series produced by Turning Point USA is now available at salemnow.com. That's salemnow.com. Watch it. You'll see what's going on at the border. You'll be better informed. We ought to have probably pushed that out earlier so that more people could have seen it, but we didn't. It comes out when it comes out, and it was great timing, but I'm not sure everyone got a chance to watch it. But it still matters, particularly with divided government. And now oversight on that board is going to pick up. Secretary Mayorkas is going to be up there in front of House Oversight and Judiciary with Jim Jordan asking the questions and his colleagues. And boy, it's going to be a different world when Jerry Nadler isn't protecting you from the incompetence at the border that saw record numbers of people cross without permission or authorization into the country over the last year. Wolf in Florida, 1-800-520-1234. I'm talking to people who watched Donald Trump last night, and I assume, Wolf, that you did.
Entirely, and I'll put it in the one word, presidential. That was the portrayal that I got from him. I'd like to think that he has a vision. I want to hear that vision, and wanted at the very end of it to make sure that the end of his campaign will be America will be safe, which we do not feel in our homes at the moment, and America will be a military leader, because through that strength, we will prevent Xi or any other little guy that wants to come up and challenge us to say, we don't want to tackle with them.
I'm happy. Well, that was Reagan's approach. Peace through strength has been Reagan's approach, and Reagan spent the money, and I talked with Mike Pompeo yesterday. We're not spending the money. And we've got to spend the money. You can't expect the American military to live on basically a budget declining by 10% this year because of inflation.
And I'm surprised it really wasn't mentioned, but again, that could be another plan that's coming forth, and I hope it does because we need that.
All right. Thank you, my friend. I want to talk to Brad in North Carolina now. Brad, how are you?
How are you?
Good. Did you listen?
I sure did. I listened to the whole thing start to finish. I'm going to be honest with you here. You know, I'm just a C-plus guy, as the late great used to joke about. And the thing about it is I'm watching these elections from the outside, and I'm with about 80% of American patriots. We saw a speech last night we were told was going to be of historical proportions, but yet it was a 2020 Trump speech just like it was last time when the fraudulent elections were stolen right out from under us. So nothing's changed, and the American people don't have faith in the election system. I'm just being honest with you.
But, Brad, what did you hear that was new or not new last night? I don't want to talk about the election system. I want to talk about former President Trump's speech.
Sure, sure. The only thing that he announced that was different that I heard, and I've been following this so closely, I've been a supporter since day one, was that he's calling for, you know, write-in hand ballots, write-in mail-in ballots, and in-person voting, which I understand is great. But the problem is we're spiraling.
Well, why did he not say enough in your view? Have you lost confidence in him?
Yeah, exactly, and I have, and unfortunately, it's not that I've lost confidence in him. I've lost confidence in our entirety of a nation to support ourselves. I feel like
that's not what I'm doing. I'm just getting. I appreciate it. I'm just getting reactions. Are you still a Trump supporter after last night?
I'll be honest with you. I don't know if I'm going to vote again, and I've voted my entire life, and I didn't say that before last night, but after last night.
Okay, Brad, I appreciate it. That's interesting. That's interesting. Lenny in Cleveland, what did you think of last night, Lenny?
Hi, Hugh. I thought two observations. I think his speaking style was much more subdued. Now, that could have been because of the venue, but he seems to have taken a lot of the rough edges off of his presentation style. And the other observation is he seemed to list a lot of the problems but didn't seem to give a hint of what kind of policy solutions he might be recommending.
Were you a supporter before, and are you a supporter after?
Oh,
or
yeah.
Were you an, okay, so you didn't...
I supported him because I thought he would had a chance to win against Hillary. I voted for him 3 times.
Now, it's interesting, he said, I am your voice. And I think that was the key line last night. Is he your voice, Lenny?
I'm sorry?
Yeah, he said, I am your voice to his supporters. Is the former president Lenny's voice?
Don't know. I mean, my concern is, he has so much negative in the electorate, I don't know that he could win. I voted for him in the 16 primary because I thought he was the only candidate that had any chance of stopping Hillary Clinton.
And he did, and he saved the Constitution by appointing 3 people in combination with Mitch McConnell and the GOP Senate to the Supreme Court. 1-800-520-1234. Get in line if you want to talk to me about what you heard Donald Trump say last night. 1-800-520-1234. Hour 2 of this morning's Hugh Hewitt Show. Straight ahead. morning, glory, America, bonjour, hi, Canada. I'm Hugh Hewitt, Inside the Beltway, live. If you are listening, you probably know I'm talking about former President Trump's speech last night, where he spoke and said the obvious, cut number 15.
In order to make America great and glorious again, I am tonight announcing my candidacy for President of the United States.
Now, it was a long speech, much longer than I expected, and I'm curious what people who watched it, I watched it, and I was surprised when Fox News cut away and had to go over to C-SPAN, but Sean Hannity had on a couple of guests, and he had to bring him on, I think, and they commented mid-speech, which was unusual for me. I didn't expect that. Up to them, of course, and they want to remind people who they are and what they're doing, and Sean's got to do a signature ID, but they didn't go back to it, at least as far as I know, because I switched over to C-SPAN. I wanted to hear what the former president had to say. What did you think about it, Joanne in Florida? Good morning, Joanne. What did you think about it?
Glory to you, Hugh. What I thought of it was this. By the time 2024 rolls around, we need a street fighter in the White House. And his speech was meat and potatoes. You were sure about what he was saying. It wasn't abstract. And it was truthful. That's how I saw it.
So were you a Trump supporter, and are you still a Trump supporter?
It's kind of like handling nitro with him. But I think if I had to choose between Trump and, say, other candidates, as I say, 2024, we need a street fighter. And he is a street fighter.
All right, Joanne, thank you. Melissa, also in Florida, did you watch it?
I did. I watched the whole thing, and I agree with the lady that was just there. I said, we need someone who's going to do what they say they're going to do, and I think that's what frightens so many people in Washington, is that Trump delivered everything that he said he was going to do for the American people, and we cannot, I don't know what the deal is with American people wanting to be nice.
Let's stay focused on the speech. Did he surprise you with anything he said or left out?
No. I do think that he mentioned more about us in this speech, like it is about us, versus the old Trump, where it was all about his accomplishments and what he had done. And I kept saying all the time, but it's about the people. We elect you. It's about our country as a whole, not about you. So I think a little bit of a narcissism needs to be cured a little bit, but I think he did that last night. It came across as something that he realized that it's about the country and they want someone that's about them. I think he's kind of figured that out.
Melissa, thank you. John in New York. Where in New York, John?
Manhattan. Hello,
where are you in New York, John?
In Manhattan.
Okay, so what'd you think?
What I think was most surprising to me is last night is what a speech you should have given in 19 or 20. I voted for him in 16. I didn't vote for him in 20. I didn't vote for anyone. I just think, at some point, it felt just like the hammer had gotten to him, and he'd changed, he's trying to change his tune, but he's still the same person.
So are you less likely or more likely to support him in 24 on the basis of what he said last night? Oh, thank you. Got to go because I'm joined by former New Jersey Governor Chris Christie, who's really got to have an interesting take. Good morning, Governor.
Good morning, Hugh. How are you?
I'm great. I gave you a hard time yesterday. You said, you didn't ask me on. So I asked you on, and I'm glad you shut up. What'd you make of former President Trump's remarks last night?
Well, look, I think they were fine. As I've said before, I've known the president for 21 years and worked very hard for him in 2016, as you know, chaired his transition and played Hillary Clinton in debate prep and chaired his opioid commission. Many of the policy things the president, former president, talked about are fine, but I think, in some ways irrelevant in the current conversation about leadership in the party and trying to win back the presidency.
Does anything he said or did yesterday impact your decision, Chris Christie, on whether or not you're going to run in 2024?
Not one bit.
And when will you decide that by?
Probably sometime in the early part of 20, first quarter, second quarter of 23.
Now, last night he didn't say anything about the 2020 election, and I found that most surprising because it's a departure from his campaign rhetoric. What do you make of that?
Well, I'm sure he's being advised by people not to, and because it's a complete loser issue for our party, as it was shown on Tuesday night. But I have no faith or confidence that that'll continue.
All right, I want to go back to Tuesday night last. You and Mike Pompeo, with support from Kevin McCarthy, did the redistricting trust on Ronna McDaniel. Thank God you did, because if New York hadn't been challenged, the Republicans wouldn't have won. Am I right about that assessment?
You're absolutely right. We picked up those seats in New York. And remember, Hugh, there were all kinds of people telling us that we were foolhardy for suing in New York. We'd never win. We got all kinds of criticism about the redistricting effort, yet we won the redistricting effort, and there is no doubt that if this margin turns out to be 219, 220, that the four seats that were picked up in New York that would not have been picked up under the original map are the difference in a Republican majority of the House. And I think, you know, Mike Pompeo and I are very proud of the work we did, and we think now it's pretty clear that our work made the difference.
Now, Governor Christie, the New Yorker, has got the perfect cover this week. An elephant standing on a surfboard with very little water underneath it. So why didn't the wave come in?
Bad candidates, Hugh, first and foremost. Bad candidates in key states. Bad candidates in Pennsylvania. Bad candidates, Dr. Oz, who could not win. Bad candidate in New Hampshire for the Senate purposes. Not a great candidate in Georgia. Fact is that Brian Kemp won that race by nearly six points, and to not be able to get over 50% in the Senate race with a governor running at that kind of pace above you is incredible. Bad candidate in Arizona in Blake Masters. And then on the gubernatorial side, bad candidate in Arizona in Carrie Lake, bad candidate in Wisconsin in Tim Michael, Tudor Dixon in Michigan, and the king of bad candidates, Doug Mastriano in Pennsylvania. The one thing they all have in common is, or they have two things in common. They were all endorsed by Donald Trump, and those endorsements were premised upon their acceptance of the lie that the 2020 election was stolen. And that's the only premise through which you get an endorser from Donald Trump. And, you know, I'm tired of losing, Q. You know, I feel like, my years as a Mets fan, you know, 2018, in 2018 we lose the House. 2020, we lose the Senate and the White House. 2021, we lose two very winnable Senate seats in Georgia. And now 2022, here we are, underperforming historic norms in the House, losing net two governorships, and losing in the Senate, one Senate.
Why did Governor DeSantis and Republicans in Florida do so well?
Well, a couple of reasons. I think, first off, Florida is now a red state. I think COVID changed Florida finally for what put them over the top in terms of, you know, more Republicans registered now than Democrats. And a lot of the migration that happened during COVID sent a lot of successful people to Florida who are Republicans. Secondly, Governor DeSantis has done a good job in Florida and ran a good campaign, and as did Marco Rubio. And so, but let's not kid ourselves. Florida is not Wisconsin anymore. Florida is not Michigan anymore. Florida is not Nevada anymore. Those are purple states. Florida is a red state now. But Governor DeSantis deserves credit for being a good governor and for running a very good race for re-election. And Marco ran a very good race for re-election to the Senate.
So, Governor, I expect you and Ted Cruz, Mike Pence, Mike Pompeo, Ron DeSantis, and Donald Trump to run for president. And I don't think anyone else is seriously considering it who would be in that top rank. Maybe Larry Hogan. I'll amend that. 7. Maybe Nikki Haley. 8. If we get enough people to declare, when should you all start getting together to talk about it? Because we got to amplify winning messages and weed out losing ones.
Look, I think that, I'd start any time. I think that what the RNC is talking about is not doing that until August, I believe.
That's next year. That's a nightmare. That's such a
Governor,
I don't know if you can stay through the break. I will appreciate it if you can. I asked you for this segment, but if you can't, don't worry about it. But if you can, come back and talk to me some more, because I always love talking to Chris Christie. He is always blunt and to the point and honest with my audience. I'll be right back, America. Stay tuned.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Birch Gold Group.
Welcome back, America. My thanks to former New Jersey Governor Chris Christie for sticking around and talking to me some more. Because, Governor, when we went to break, you were telling me the RNC doesn't plan to put candidates on a stage until August. I don't know if you saw J.D. Vance, the senator-elect from Ohio. He wrote in the American Conservative about our small-dollar donor disadvantage. It's significant. It's massive. One way to close it is to get our candidates on a stage talking about our messages. Why would the RNC wait till August?
You know, I don't know, Hugh. I think, you know, they're doing the same thing they did 4 years ago. I think it's cookie cutter and it's easy. And I think that's what they're going to do. Now that can always change. And certainly candidates can make an agreement to go out there and do these things together as well. You know, me, Hugh, I've never been reluctant to get on the stage with anybody, and have a conversation and, but, you know, look, in the end of the day, what we need to do is to start talking about, as you said, our Republican issues. And we didn't win on Tuesday in the way we should have because we ran bad candidates who were giving, not completely, but in the main, messages that were not credible. And I think voters just said, yeah, no, thank you. I don't know, thank you, in Arizona. Now, imagine this. Doug Ducey won by 13 points in 2014 and by 15 points in 2018. This should not have even been a close race in Arizona for the governorship there. And when we're not winning those kind of races, if we can't be competitive, Hugh, statewide in Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania, there is no electoral math that gets a Republican the presidency.
Yeah, there's no path. So, let me ask you, do you think Mitch McConnell should be reelected leader of the Republican caucus?
Look, I've never worked with Mitch McConnell, but I will tell you this. I think he does a very good job at managing a very unruly and difficult caucus. And so, from my perspective, I think Mitch McConnell is the leader of the Senate Republicans, and I think he should continue to be.
All right, now, my last question has to do with China. Justin Trudeau got slapped around body language-wise by General Secretary Xi Jinping, and it's on tape, and we see him. I mean, he's just getting dismissed. He's being dismissed. China is our number one issue, in Hugh Hewitt's view, starting with banning TikTok. What does Chris Christie think about this?
Well, look, I said years ago, Hugh, that we should ban TikTok. I've been on this issue for years now, and there's no question. I don't think China understands anything but the stick. In the carrot and stick analogy, I don't think they understand anything but someone being tough with them, because let's face it, they're thieves, Hugh. They steal our ideas, they steal our intellectual property, they steal from entrepreneurs in the United States, and they make no apologies for it. And that goes over into spying on us in things regarding national security. The islands in the South China Sea, where they've put military capability and bases that are going to impact potentially our ability to have trade. Look, the time has come for us to admit that the things that we did with China early about trying to encourage them, all it did was make them stronger. And they have not reformed in any way. And we need to now use the economic leverage that the United States still has. To be much tougher with China.
I think it's a national security emergency, Governor. It's a national security emergency that I think the Democrats are blissfully unaware of or refusing to talk about. And the president's meeting with Xi left me thinking of Kennedy and Khrushchev in Vienna in 1961. What do you think of the president and Xi?
No, look, Joe Biden is not equipped to sit across from President Xi and be a formidable force on behalf of the United States. And I think that was obvious from watching the two of them interact. I think we're spending a lot of time and energy on Russia as a geopolitical opponent. You know, and I think what we're doing in Ukraine and supporting the Ukrainians is the right thing to do. But we're not focused on the real game. That's like being focused on the preliminary bout in a card of boxing matches. The real bout is us in China, and we better get to it, or they're gonna eat our lunch, you.
They are eating our lunch. That's why we need Republican candidates talking to each other about China and the Select Committee on China set up. Governor Chris Christie, always a pleasure to talk to you. Thank you, Governor. Short notice and you show up. Boy, I like that. At the Switzerland of the Republican Party, I'm Hugh Hewitt. All Republican candidates for president, welcome anytime. Come right back. More ahead. matters.
Okay.
Yeah, you bring. Here we go. Now you're there.
Yeah.
Now my first question: how many Republicans will there be in January?
You know, I think Dwayne's muting me just to make me look bad. This is a classic Dwayne sabotage opportunity.
He does that to me a lot.
Well, we'll definitely have the majority, but we don't know the precise number of seats. There are at least a few seats in California that have yet to be counted. What's going on with your state, Hugh? Why can't California get their election sorted out? Now, the good news is...
I'm a Virginian.
The good news is that Ken Calvert's race has been called. Ken won, and Ken's going to be critical in the next Congress because he will chair the Defense Appropriations Subcommittee. And Ken is very thoughtful, very forward-leaning when it comes to military modernization. So that was a key race that we won. So I don't know if we're going to land at 219 seats, 222 seats, but we're going to have a majority. It's going to be a narrow majority, which means we're going to have to act with discipline. And I think the one area where we can make a lot of progress, even in a divided Congress and divided government where the two parties disagree on major things, is when it comes to China. I think we have an opportunity to lay a bipartisan foundation for U.S. foreign policy. Now, there's still going to be disagreements between the parties. I think Biden's overall foreign policy is a shambles right now. I think they're actually projecting weakness when it comes to China. But I do think there are members on both sides of the aisle that understand that China is our biggest threat. And so we can work together in order to get some big things done in this Congress when a lot of what we're going to be doing is not moving big legislation. It's just going to be basic oversight and holding the executive branch accountable.
Mike Gallagher, you're on Intel, you're on Armed Services, both key committees. Is Leader McCarthy, soon to be Speaker McCarthy, going to establish the Select Committee? Do you want to be on it? Do you want to be chair? And what do we know about it?
Yes, and yes. He is going to establish the committee. It was in his commitment to America. I know he's constantly talking about, you know, what he views to be the biggest threats to our country, a combination of China and our looming debt crisis. And so I know he is committed to creating the Select Committee on China. And if he asked me to serve on it, I would do so gladly. You know, I've spent a lot of my efforts in Congress the last 6 years trying to get us ready to win this new Cold War with China and trying to reestablish deterrence in the near term. And there's where I really think the Select Committee on China can have an impact, right? It can coordinate among the various committees, among Armed Services, among Foreign Affairs, among Intel, to make sure that we are all kind of moving in the same direction and making sure that we are ensuring the administration is doing some basic things like clearing the backlog, the $14 billion worth of a backlog of military assistance to Taiwan, things that have been approved but not yet delivered, expanding our stockpiles of munitions in the Indo-Pacific. And then when it comes to sort of non-military things, I think the committee would be a great mechanism to elevate certain issues such as the pernicious role that TikTok is playing in America. Myself and Senator Rubio have introduced the bill that would ban TikTok. I can tell you, Hugh, that at least in the House, this is going to be a bipartisan bill. I'm not yet ready to announce my Democratic co-sponsor, but there will be Democratic co-sponsors. So I'm very optimistic that on those issues, we can really use the Select Committee on China to kind of apprise the American people about why they should care about the threat posed by the Chinese Communist Party.
If you're on that committee, whether or not you're chair, and no matter who is the chair, I'm going to lobby everyone to regularly schedule meetings and make sure C-SPAN is in the room and use it to advance the American public's knowledge of China, and that you hire Mandarin-speaking experts and that you make these basically intended not to score political points, but to educate the American people, like a new long telegram, a virtual long telegram for the new millennium, because nobody gets it, Congressman. I mean, some people do, but not a lot of people get it.
100%, Hugh. Again, explaining why it matters to the American people, I think, is going to be a core task of this committee. You know, it's not about obscure territorial claims in the South and East China Sea. It's not about these fancy phrases we throw around like a rules-based international order. It's about the fact that the Chinese Communist Party is trying to destroy us. They wouldn't put it in precisely those terms, but their goal is to destroy the capitalist-led system that the United States is the leader of and prepare the way for the triumph of world socialism with Chinese characteristics. So we need to understand how and why they're doing it. And in many ways, they're doing it subtly. You can think about it sort of like an assisted suicide cue. They're supplying us with the chemicals in the form of fentanyl. They're imposing upon us economic devastation in the form of coronavirus, IP theft, and economic warfare. They're cutting us off. They're trying to cut us off from our friends and isolate us on the world stage. And then they're also supplying the self-loathing and depression in the form of ideological warfare, co-opting some of the radical left anti-American narratives and promoting that so that we start to lose faith in ourselves as the good guys. This is all happening right under our noses. And if we have serious members, and if we have a staff, as you point out, that has the requisite expertise, language skills, I think we can do this in a way that is aggressive, but still serious and statesmanlike, right? You don't want this to descend into some form of McCarthyism. And I'm painfully aware of that because I come from the district where Joe McCarthy is buried. And I'm the second Marine intelligence officer ever elected to Congress from Wisconsin, the first being McCarthy. So we can do this in a way that doesn't go overboard. That's smart, serious, sober, but still strong.
Do you remember the Kefauver Committee on Organized Crime? It actually opened America's eyes to organized crime, and it was must-watching. People watched it because it was organized to be produced for television. So I hope if it's you or whoever is chair, organizes in such a way that television thinks it's must-see TV. January 6th committee, I didn't watch a minute of it. I read the summaries thereafter. That didn't matter to me because I know what happened on January 6th. I want the American people to know what's happening with China. Congressman, did you watch former President Trump last night?
I did not. I was at the AEI gala honoring Arthur Brooks, listening to his speech at that same time it happened. So I've not yet caught up.
Well, you can read the accounts of it. Do you expect to endorse anyone for president early, or are you going to wait it out?
I do not. I mean, I want to see everyone who's running. I think it'd be healthy for us to have a very vigorous debate. And I think we got a lot of talent on our side, right? I mean, obviously, after this election, you know, DeSantis crushed it. In Florida, he's an exciting candidate. In your new home state of Virginia, Governor Youngkin is very impressive, very smart. And then, of course, we have the veterans, right? I know Tom Cotton has said he's not going to run, but Pompeo, who formerly held this slot, though Cotton called him an interloper on your program. I just want to yes, point that did. Out. Incredibly
Dreyer
smart,
to Campbell know. To Cotton to Pompeo to Gallagher. That's it. That's the slot.
To quote Shakespeare, oh, what a falling off there was. But Tim Scott, phenomenal. So I want to see everyone running out there. I think we should have a vigorous debate about the future of the party. My preference, however, Hugh, I will say in your program, is for a generational shift. I really think, particularly if you look at the ages of the Democratic leadership, not just Biden, but Pelosi, Clyburn, the top three Democrats in the House are older than the Republic itself. I think it would be valuable for us to be the party that's advocating for a generational shift, both in terms of our candidate and in terms of our forward-leaning agenda, just for modernizing all these outdated boomer-built bureaucracies that are just not up to the challenges of the 21st century. And I include the military bureaucracy in that conversation. So I think we got a lot of good candidates on our side. I want to see them debate.
Let me pause and pose this question, which a mutual friend of ours said. They're despairing over the leadership election because Jim Banks, the veteran, did not make it. Tom Emmers, the NRCC, did. And that they're afraid that defense spending is simply not going to be there. That this group of McCarthy, Scalise, and Emmer are not defense hawks. I don't agree with that. I think they are. And I believe you will push through a defense budget. But what say you, Mike Gallagher, on Armed Services Intel and probably on the new China Committee?
Well, I openly supported Banks also because he's a veteran and I like, veteran voices in House leadership, in presidential candidates as well. That's great. But I think it's more a pressure on us on the Armed Services Committee to really make the case for why more defense spending is necessary. And we can do it while also pursuing necessary reforms of the Pentagon bureaucracy and making sure some of the pernicious progressive social issues don't infect the military and don't distract from our war fighting focus. So I think there's actually a way to bridge the gap in the caucus going forward. And again, I think all of our presidential candidates should be asked. You know, when we first met you, when I was working on the Walker campaign, you did a great job of asking everybody who came on your program about nuclear submarines and what was their plan, right? And I think we're going to have to hold every candidate for president's feet to the fire when it comes to their plan for the military. And maybe the TikTok question can also become your new diagnostic question. Ask them if they support the Rubio Gallagher bill on TikTok and see what they say.
I do have. I've asked Chris Christie that this morning. I asked Mike Pompeo that yesterday. I did not ask Mike Pence that yesterday. We ran out of time, but they're all on board. I don't know why we're delaying with this. Okay, Congressman, last question. Why did we not do what we expected? The New Yorker cover is perfect. An elephant standing on a surfboard with very little water underneath it. What happened?
I think it's a combination of subpar candidates in key races. Abortion was clearly a bigger issue than perhaps we understood. And then the ground game in Wisconsin, the Democrats put out with their low-dollar donor operation. I mean, their turnout rates in Dane County, which is our most progressive county, that's where UW-Madison is, they got younger voters out there, and they were all voting Democrats. We need to understand that. We need to counter it. And rather than whining about past elections, we're just going to have to up our game and figure out a way to win, right? More winning, less whining. Let's go forward. We can win these races, but we need good candidates and good operations going forward in a great ground game.
More winning, less whining. Is that yours?
You inspire me. The muse hits me whenever I'm on the Hewitt Show.
I'm glad that you credited me, so I'll use that now. More winning, less whining. Congressman Mike Gallagher, Rep. Gallagher on Twitter. Thank you, Congressman. Always a pleasure. And we won't talk about football for the rest of the year, as a matter of fact. We're done with football. Let's start talking about basketball. All right? We're both done with football.
Right.
Thank you, Congressman. I got to tell you, this is going to be the TikTok question, maybe my diagnostic question. It's not enough, though. I'm convinced that China is the bigger question, and TikTok is a diagnostic on it, and so is our submarine budget. And so I'm going to go after the submarine budget. When anyone comes to talk to me, I also am going to ask them if they're using their relief factor. Not really. Some people take different things. I take relieffactor.com. Pretty much everyone I know, though, takes Icarian and curcumin, resveratrol, and omega in some form or another in different regimes. I just like to make it easy because I don't have a lot of patience for a lot of jars of pills and a lot of complexity. I've never been a supplement guy. You've never heard me endorse supplements on this show. And so the only thing I take is relieffactor.com and then whatever my doctor tells me to take. And that's what you should be doing. Relieffactor.com is all natural, wonderfully produced, necessary for any balanced intake of the nutrients that help support your natural anti-inflammatory system. Quick recovery from exercise, less impact from aging. That's all you need to know. And Charlie from Cleveland in the front row was about, 30? Were you 32, Charlie? And came up to me and said, I had a tennis elbow in my left elbow for a year. It never went away. And then it finally got, I got PT. It went away. Then I got it in my right elbow. And I said, I'm going to listen to Hewitt. I'm going to try Relief Factor. And Charlie in the front row said it went away before the 3 weeks were done. And he bought the ticket and sat in the front row so he could tell me that. I love that. And I know some of you say it doesn't work for you, but that is not, in fact, true unless you've tried it for 3 weeks. ReliefFactor.com, $19.95, $20. Give it a shot. Wesbury is next. Don't go anywhere, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by PhD Weight Loss and Nutrition. Go to myphdweightloss.com to learn more.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Brian Wesbury, of course, First Trust Portfolio Lead Economist. Good morning, Brian. Welcome back. I have got to ask you about the crypto crisis. Sam Bankman-Fried has brought down billions of dollars of wealth. It's bankrupt. Other ones are teetering. I've always told my audience, don't invest in anything you don't understand. And if you're putting money into crypto, be prepared to lose it. What do you say?
I totally agree. I've been saying for years that I didn't. People who think there are two reasons to believe in crypto. One is that it's sort of the grease in the wheels of the blockchain, and I won't go any further than that. But you sort of have to get a blockchain, and that's kind of what a coin or an NFT is. And then once you have that, blockchain's really cool stuff. It is going to change the way we use the internet. The other reason that people support crypto is they think it's going to be our currency. And I have to tell you, Hugh, let's say Bitcoin. I know there's a million of these things out there. But Bitcoin, it has an algorithm that says you can only make 21 million of them. And as a result, it's better than the gold standard, actually. Think about it this way. If Bitcoin really was our money, they could have never done quantitative easing, and if they wanted to spend $5 trillion during the COVID crisis to pay people not to work, they actually would have really had to borrow the money from somewhere else, because you can't just make more Bitcoin. But here's the problem. Because of that, government will never let it exist. If the IRS will never let you pay your taxes in Bitcoin. It will never have the IRS will never have a Bitcoin account where it holds it just like currency. And as a result, it will never become our money.
Bitcoin went from $62,000 a coin a year ago to $16,000 today. That's not stable. That's gambling.
No, well, it's more than that. Bitcoin's a really cool invention. It is, but government wants control of the money supply. This is why we have inflation today. The quantitative easing that the Federal Reserve has done, they could have never done if they had Bitcoin as our money. And so they will never let that be. Now, there's a reason. I don't know what the correct value for Bitcoin is, whether it's $500 or $1,000 or $10,000 or $20,000. But imagine if you have to buy something from a producer in Turkey, let's say, and they want Turkish lira, and you work in Nebraska, and you have a local Nebraska bank. How are you going to pay them lira? So what you can do is you can get a crypto account, send them a couple of Bitcoin. You buy $6,000 worth of stuff, but it doesn't matter what Bitcoin's worth. It could be one Bitcoin, it could be four Bitcoin, it could be half a Bitcoin, and they can take the Bitcoin, convert it into Turkish lira, and life goes on. And that way, you avoid the SWIFT and wire transfer systems and all of that kind of stuff. So there's a potential use for this, but it doesn't mean Bitcoin has to be worth $60,000. It could be worth more.
But Brian, to investors, unless you understand it.
I wouldn't touch it.
Don't touch it.
I wouldn't touch it. Yes.
How far will this spread? I mean, I think there's a house of cards that's coming down.
Well, I'm not an expert on all the intricate, cross investments between this platform and that platform and all of the things. But any part of this rise in this whole world that was based on the belief that Bitcoin was going to be our money, that's going to fall apart. Or any of these currencies are going to be our money.
It is not a reserve currency. It cannot be a reserve currency, is what I hear Brian Wesbury saying.
That's exactly right. But remember, this blockchain stuff, this is really cool stuff.
It is. I don't know. People might want to invest in people who are really smart who do this, but it is not for people with their retirement funds. I mean, just isn't.
No. Well, by the way, all these pandemic unemployment, well, I shouldn't say all. A lot people were getting these checks deposited in their accounts, opening a Coinbase account, buying Bitcoin, and thinking they were going to become millionaires from the handouts from government. And that's by the way, all these do you see Target today is all we spent $1.3 trillion more on goods, on stuff during the pandemic because you couldn't go to a basketball, football, baseball game. You couldn't go to a movie. You couldn't go out to dinner. And you were getting a check for more than you used to make. And so people bought stuff. They bought crypto. They bought river rafts and backyard pools and Pelotons. And all of that's coming crashing down now.
Yeah, it is. And by the way, Brian warned you about that on this show for a couple of years. Jeff Bezos said that, by the way, on CNN yesterday as well. And one of the most important things he's ever said, which is, slow down, America, hold on to your cash. Thank you, Brian Wesbury. Follow him on Twitter at Wesbury. Follow me to hour number three. More of my interview with Mike Pence from yesterday coming up. More reaction to Donald Trump's speech last night. Chris Christie's remarks about it this morning. Stay tuned. Morning, Glory America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt live inside the Beltway. 1-800-520-1234. I want to hear from you about what you thought about President Trump's speech last night. I do want to tell you, before we go there, that Andrew Del Rey sent me an email yesterday, and andrewandtodd.com are sponsors of the show. They're great sponsors. 888-1172. One of the most interesting emails about equity and housing and why you should not wait to buy a house, even though interest rates are now in the sevens. If you have really great credit and you're putting enough down, you might get in the sixes, but they're in the sevens right now, and they're going to go higher. And what he was pointing out to me, because I asked him, is that the net worth of people who invested in real estate before they were 35 by buying their own house is significantly higher at 65 than those who started at 45. And the same is true of those who started at 25 as opposed to those who didn't. Income, reality, and growth in equity depends on owning a home for most Americans over a long period of time. Go to andrewandtodd.com, 888-1172. Joined now by the next senator from Georgia, Herschel Walker. Good morning, Herschel. How are you?
Oh, I'm doing well. How are you doing?
I'm great. Are you happy with the way the campaign is moving forward? Pretty much everyone expected a runoff. You're in a runoff, but you're running from behind.
Well, I'm happy that we're in this runoff. You know, I thought we can win outright. I think he was looking forward to a runoff. I think the Georgia people want a senator that's going to speak for them. And in less than 2 years, Senator Warnock has shown that he's not going to speak for the Georgia people. So if we have to go through a runoff, we're going to go through a runoff. Because the Georgia people deserve to have someone to go to Washington that's going to stand with them and speak for them.
Now, this race means an enormous amount, Herschel Walker, to a 50-50 Senate. It splits the committees. It doesn't give control to Leader McConnell again, but it splits the committees 50-50, and it sets us up for 2024. So is every Republican helping you?
Well, I have a lot of people coming down to help. And, you know, I welcome anyone that want to come down to help for me to win this seat for the great people of Georgia. This is an important seat. I don't think people realize what it means, but they also don't realize having a leader in Washington can get people to change over. You know, I'm willing, and I said it from the beginning, to be a uniter. I'm willing to go over and cross the aisle and talk to other people as well and try to talk to them about what this country really means, because it seems like a lot of people on the left forget about America is the greatest country in the world. This is the greatest country in the world, the United States of America. And the way we can get things done is by working together, not trying to fight each other and fight each other over everything, but just try to work together.
Now, small-dollar donors matter a lot. J.D. Vance wrote a piece about campaigning for Senate 2 days ago, which opened my eyes to the small-dollar donor gap between Democrats and Republicans. How are you doing with small-dollar donors, Herschel Walker?
We're doing well. Right now, we got to continue to go out, and people go to TeamHerschel.com. Right now, they've been trying to buy this seat. I think everyone saw that in the general election. They were trying to buy this seat. They raised a lot of money. They spent a lot of money against me. And to go into a tie right now, as you can tell, that they're not spending their money wisely. Why in the world are they spending our money? Right now, we just got to continue to go out and raise money, but I got to get out and meet the people that didn't vote for me. I need to let them know what I stand for and what he stands for and who he exactly is. I think people don't know that he's not the person he claimed to be. I think they see now after that debate that, you know, the things he's done at the apartment building that he owns, how horrible that they have that apartment building. And the conditions that they have there, they find dead bodies there that nobody's been accounted for. But as a senator, he's failed Georgia as a senator. Right now, in less than 2 short years, we have this high inflation. Whereas, you know, I think the best thing you could do with this high inflation is become energy independent again. And that can start putting money into this economy that can also start to help people to get back to working. And I think that's one thing we got to do. And then we got the crime out on the streets. We got so much crime because having a senator in Washington that believes in no cash bail, he's believing that we got to open up the prison, let prisoners out without them serving their sentence. You know, that's not right. And so, I think half a senator that is going to fight against things like that is what I'm going to do.
Now, in overtime, I mean, you're used to overtime, but nevertheless, a lot of people are weary of politics. Are you going to get the same turnout or less in three more weeks? I think it's in three more weeks, isn't it? I'm not sure the date of the...
It's a short period of time now. Well, that's what we're doing. We're getting out. As soon as we knew that we were going to be going in a runoff, the next day we were out on the stump, going into it, talking to a lot of people, letting them know what I stand for and what we're doing, and people started coming in, and we're getting the word out.
Can people vote early in Georgia, Herschel? Can they go now and vote?
They only have a short time to vote early, and because we have such a short time, you know, now it's December the 6th, where it used to go into January, so you only have a shorter time right now to vote early. So that's what makes it a little even tougher on people. But those are the rules, you know, because of the holiday is also in this. You had the holiday in it, so it makes things even tougher. But those were the rules that they've set. So those are the rules that I play by. Those are the rules that I think everybody got to play by. You know, we knew this at the beginning, and right now we just got to play by the rules that we have.
So what is the most important part of the voting public that you need to reach in the next 2 weeks?
Well, the most important part of the voting public is the people that didn't vote. The people that didn't vote, we would need to get them to come out and vote. And the people that did vote, we need to remind them, you got to come back out and vote. This is not over. This is not over. And I want them to know that they got to have their voices heard and their vote counted. Because right now, we got to get people in Washington that's going to do the right thing by the Georgia people. That's also can be a leader. They can be a leader because, you know, I think that's what we've been lacking in Washington for a while is leadership. And I think we see it right now as we see the president over into China, as the things he was doing in China, the leadership is not there. And I think when Americans lead, this whole world does well. Right now, I think the world is in disarray because we're not sure what's going on, you know, with the economy of the U.S. Underwater. The economy in the whole world is sort of underwater, and I think that is the problem. But we can get things back together. I think if we come together, we can get things back together, get it working well.
I am just curious about, last question, Herschel Walker, teamherschel.com, if you want to help Herschel out, especially my AM920 audience and my other audiences in Georgia. Go out there and work the campaign, get people to vote. The bus tour that you were doing, did you take a break, or are you still on the road in Georgia in the Team Herschel bus?
No, we're still on the road. That's what I said I was going to do is we're going to continue to work. Now, like I said, they're going to raise a lot of money, so I want people to help me to raise money, but I want to get more votes. That's one of the things I'm going to work on is getting more votes. We're going to hit the road as soon as we knew it was a tie. We didn't stop. We hit the road right again and got getting back out, meeting the people on the stump, letting people know the contrast between the two of us.
So Mike Pompeo told me yesterday, tell him when to come. Donald Trump endorsed you last night. Every Republican will work for you. I imagine your scheduler is kind of crazy, but please keep coming back to the Hugh Hewitt Show. Herschel, congratulations on getting to the runoff, and run strong and hard through the tape.
Hey, thank you, Nine. God bless everyone. And we're going to get this thing back together. Just vote for Herschel Walker. We're going to get things back together.
Thank you, Senator-to-be Herschel Walker. Now let me go and talk with a couple of people about last night's speech. Roger in Ohio, what did you think of Donald Trump last night?
Good morning, Hugh. Thanks for taking my call. Let me make it clear. I support the Bucks. I support C.J. Stroud for the Heisman. I voted for the guy twice, but unless he's nominated, I'm not supporting him. I'm sorry.
Did you listen last night?
I did. I listened to about 80% of it.
And what did you think?
I thought it sounded a little bit like a State of the Union address. I thought it was clear and concise, classic Trump. But, again, I just I'm not in position to support him this time around. But unless he's the nominee, of course, that changes everything. But I'm just not sure he's electable this time.
All right, Roger, thank you. Tom in Texas, what say you, Tom?
I'm totally against him running again.
But what did you think of the speech? The question is, what did you think of the speech?
Oh, well, I got to fess up. I did not listen to him, this speech, because I don't listen to him anymore.
All right. I accept that, Tom, but I want to stay on the topic. Richard in Texas, did you listen to the speech?
Yes.
What'd you think?
I appreciated it, actually, because
I feel like Trump got us all the way this way. I feel like he got us this far, and we just got to keep hoping him. You know, he actually opened my eyes in a 31-year-old male like from South Dallas.
All right, get those kids to school, Richard. And thank you for calling. I'll be right back, America. 1-800-520-1234. If you watched the speech, I want to know what you thought of the speech, not what you think about, you know, the weather or anything else. But what did you think of the speech? 1-800-520-1234. Connection to me, Hugh Hewitt. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Coming up after the break, part three of my interview with former Vice President Michael Pence about his book that came out. You know, we had a long conversation over at my podcast if you want to hear the whole hour, but I want to play a key segment of it for you. So Help Me God is the title of his new book. Before I go there, though, market report. Crypto is in trouble. Birchgold.com, or HughGold.com leads you to Birchgold. If you're going to say, you know what, I just want to batten down the hatches and I'm going to move money out of my crypto account, which has gone down by 80% rather than watch it ride to zero, and I want to buy something that I can put in my safety deposit box and forget about it forever because I can't do that with Bitcoin or any of the other cryptos, go to HughGold.com or text Hugh to 989898. Gold this morning is at 1,784. It's up a 0.5% over yesterday. The reason it's going to keep going up is that people get nervous when stuff starts falling apart. The Chinese real estate market is falling apart. The cryptocurrency exchange that Sam SBF, Bankman-Fried, started is falling apart. Associated crypto infrastructure is falling apart. Bitcoin was $60,000 a year ago. Over 52 weeks, it's been 60,948. This morning it's at 16,584. You know what didn't do that? Gold. Gold did not go and lose 3/4 to 4/5 of its value over the course of the last year. It held its value. That's why you buy gold. That's why you go to HughGold.com and say, I want to set up my IRA. I want to roll over an IRA. I want to buy some bullion. I want to buy some Krugerrands, some American Eagles, some Maple Leaf. Doesn't matter. They're all good. They're just gold. And that's the great thing about it, the universal currency. You put in your safety deposit box, 5 to 10% of your wealth ought to be in physical precious metals, whether it's in a third-party administered depository like Birch Gold. That's what they do. They also sell you gold, or in your safety deposit box, go and do it. Because I'm going to watch the crypto story. I just think it's a nightmare for people. And I'm sorry if you got caught up in it. It's not my fault. David in North Carolina, did you listen to the speech?
Yeah, you... I thought the speech was great. He didn't rehash all the old grievances, which
that's
was
right.
Good.
That's right. He did not.
Hopefully, he's learned. But I'm telling you, the first time he brings up 2020, I'm out.
That's well said, David. Thank you, Tim in Virginia. What do you think, Tim, about the speech last night?
Hey, you. Great job. Appreciate listening to you every morning.
Thank you.
Yeah. I think he came across as ready to fight again. And I think the last caller put it in good terms. If he rehashes 2020, everybody's just going to turn him off. But if he gets up there, fights, gives a good message, says what he's going to do for the American people, gives inspiration, hope, you know, and really sets us on the world stage again, as leaders, I think he's got a chance. But, you know, it is Trump, and... You know, you just got to kind of, you know, you got to assess them every day.
Thank you much, Tim. Jack in Florida. What did you think, Jack? 1-800-520-1234.
Yes, sir. I watched the speech, the entire speech last night. I thought he was on point. I was glad that he did not, like your other callers, you know, said, bring up old grievances about 2020. I think a lot of us are tired of that. And I think that he's already demonstrated that he could get the job done. And I think that if he continues that message, stays on message, I think he will win back some of these supporters that have dropped off.
When do you want the Republicans who are running? And that includes Mike Pompeo. I think it's going to include Pompeo and DeSantis and Ted Cruz and Chris Christie and Larry Hogan. Maybe when do you want them to get together and start talking about these things?
I think they should. I was listening to the conversation you had with Christie earlier, and I think August of 23 is way too late.
Oh gosh, it's such earlier. It's so dumb. You know, I just so dumb.
I don't have a specific day, but I just know that's too late. They need to start as soon as they can. Actually,
Jack, thank you. Will in Arizona, you have like 30 seconds, Will, but I want to get you in before I play Mike Pence from yesterday. Go ahead, Will.
Good morning, sir. My wife and I are both retired law enforcement. She was a dispatcher. I retired a detective out of violent crimes. But you know what? a very informative speech, very educational, and I tell you what, he's taking the arrows, and if we don't wake up, we're not going to see the light. No one's going to see the light for a long time.
So is that a yes? You're still with him?
Yes.
Okay, I thought so. I just wanted to make sure the audience understood. Come right back, America. Mike Pence on his book, So Help Me God, coming up. Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt live inside the Beltway on this Wednesday. Yesterday, I spoke with former Vice President Mike Pence about his brand new and very wonderful memoir, So Help Me God. Here's part of the conversation. It aired yesterday in my podcast, but not on the air, and I want to play it for you today. Let's roll that. I am curious that you shun talk radio during the vice presidency, and I don't mind. I don't begrudge you that. If you make a mistake, if you are the president,
I
make
did
a mistake.
Your show.
once in 4 years, and I got to say, I understand that because if you make a mistake or you're misunderstood, missiles can fly, right? So my question is, what is the right balance for a president communicating with the American people? How often should they talk to reporters at length or in short form? Because this president, President Biden, doesn't do it at all. I mean,
I think it was one of the great virtues of our administration was we had a president who was accessible to the American people virtually on a daily basis, talking to the press. Now, for my part, and I hope this comes through in the chapters that open up my years in service as vice president. But in So Help Me God, I try and speak about my approach. You know, I wrote on the mirror at the vice president's residence in the early days after studying the vice presidency and some of my predecessors. My job was to be informed, be of service, and be prepared. To your point, I believe it's not the vice president's job to be the story. For my part, I thought that my job was to be there to support the president, to support the policies of the administration. And I was always loyal to President Donald Trump. He was my president. He was my friend. The only higher loyalty is to God and the Constitution. And I always tried to reflect that humility and understanding the role of the vice president.
The best anecdote on that, Mr. Vice President, and I have interviewed, you know, I worked for Nixon twice, and I have interviewed Dan Quayle and Dick Cheney and Mike Pence 1,000 times, and so I know vice presidents. The best part of this book is your approach to entering the Oval Office, because it. I know you gave the Hillsdale speech on the presidency, which I got to go back and read now, but would you explain to people, as you do in the book, your approach to entering the Oval Office?
Well, thank you for mentioning that. In So Help Me God, I wrote a whole chapter on my approach to the way I operated as vice president. And one of the things was that I literally never walked into the Oval Office without being invited by the President of the United States. I the Bible has many admonitions about waiting to be called up, right? And demonstrating humility and orientation to authority. And it was a small thing, Hugh, but I always sensed that the president appreciated it. You know, other senior staffers, other cabinet members would come walking in for a meeting, and I almost invariably would arrive at the door, wait till I caught his eye, and then either with a wave or a come on in, Mike, I'd walk in. And it was just a small token of me trying to demonstrate every day the respect that I had, that I wasn't elected president of the United States. The Oval Office wasn't my office. I always wanted to show respect and deference to the president. And I think it was one of those small deposits in our relationship that created the kind of trust and the kind of successful working relationship and friendship that we enjoyed for all of those 4 years. Obviously, it didn't end well. I write about that candidly. In So Help Me God, but I'll always be proud of those years in the Trump-Pence administration and grateful for the relationship that I enjoyed with President Donald Trump.
You know, Mr. Vice President, I have not spent any time at all on January 6th for the simple reason that everybody asks you about it, and the book is so doggone good in other places, I'm just going to cover the ground that isn't there. I got to ask you, though, when I was a guest of Vice President and Mrs. Cheney for dinner with the Fetching Mrs. Hewitt, there was a shelf in the Vice President's office or room where every vice presidential book, a book written by a vice president, was on display. And I looked up and there were two that I'd helped, Dan Quayle and Richard Nixon, The Real War. Did you keep that tradition going? Because if so, So Help Me God will end up there.
Well, we did keep that tradition going. And I'll be honest with you, that was when I became acquainted with Calvin Coolidge's autobiography, which I pulled it off the shelf one Sunday afternoon, read through it a couple of hours, and And I read through a number of those biographies, and it's a tradition that we kept. And my hope is that in the not too distant future, so help me God, I'll be up on that shelf.
All right. So now I have not done one single question from my list here, and I think I have you for another half hour. So I'm going to go through my list. Throughout my last year, I have heard from longtime evangelical friends, and you and I are evangelical. I'm still an evangelical Roman Catholic Presbyterian. I go to both Catholic Mass and Presbyterian services. So you and I speak the same language because you are a Catholic turned evangelical, but you didn't go back yet. Yeah, you go back over the Tiber. But I have never run across the so-called Christian nationalism about which the left frets. And I've got good, dear friends that, Christian nationalism threatens the country. It's just not there. Do you agree or disagree with that assessment, Mr. Vice President?
I haven't had any personal experience with it either. I mean, I'll be honest with you that all those 4 years, the campaign in 2016 and the campaign for re-election in 2020, I mean, as I say in the book, that I'd stood in front of crowds, large and small. I always told people if you wanted a big crowd, we'd send President Trump. If you want a small crowd, I can go. It was always the same people, Hugh. I mean, it was the most God-fearing, patriotic, law-abiding people of every race, creed, and color, every background, city people, country people. It was deeply inspiring, and I've seen the stereotype in the media about this Christian nationalism stuff, and it's outside my experience. I'd never witnessed it.
You and me both. Now I want to talk about President Trump because on page 148, you give another clue to his appeal that will surprise the left if they will simply read, so help me God. I want to read the whole paragraph, Mr. Vice President. Our day at Bedminster provided a clue as to why he was winning. He spent most of his time talking to the men and women working on the grounds and in the club, the people who made the place run with their hands. It was clear that he motivated them and made them feel seen and respected. That was the secret of his success, first as a businessman, now as a politician. He didn't talk to the contractors, he talked to the subcontractors. I understood it. I'd seen it before. My dad had the same quality. He was just as comfortable talking to the mechanic working at one of his gas stations as he was the CEO of Marathon Oil. With that background, I could see that Trump understood voters in a way that more conventional politicians couldn't. Did he lose the thread or does he still have it, Mr. Vice President?
Well, that'd be for others to say. What I can tell you is it made an early impression on me. I could see the connection that he made. You know, you made the comment that I was I actually was with another candidate in the 2016 primary in Indiana, and I do make mention of the fact that after I endorsed Ted Cruz, he won every county I campaigned with him in, all three of them, and Donald Trump won the other eight. But after that was over in 2016, I was convinced every day, even before he tapped me to be on the ticket, and even after a fall campaign where every single poll in the country said that we were going to lose by a little or lose by a lot, I was absolutely convinced that Donald Trump was going to be the 45th president of the United States because I saw that connection. And as you said as you recited in that quote from the book, I'd seen it before. My dad had the same quality. The ground was level around my dad. He showed great respect for everybody, whether you worked in an office or you worked with your hands. And frankly, I always had the impression that that President Trump's father was the same kind of self-made man, that he had he had grown up or in a family that that understood and respected that all honest work is honorable. And that was a big part of the connection that he made, I believe it.
Mr. Vice President, you also talk about the former president's ability to act. And I don't know if Dwayne, our wonderful producer, went and found, as a talk radio host alum, everything depends upon the producer. I asked him at a last minute last night to find the George C. Scott portrayal of General Patton that you cite. Dwayne, did you find that? Can we play it for the audience in case, or maybe not? Okay. We don't have Patton. But you talk about him chewing out the cabinet, then they leave and they turn to you and winks at you, basically, and says, how'd I do? How much theater, how much reality with Donald Trump?
Well, of course, I'm people actually around me accuse me of being a movie buff. You know, I love movies. Karen and I used to leave movie reviews on our answering machine when we were newlyweds.
That's not in the book. At least if you did, I missed it.
It's actually true. But Patton is a great movie, but there's a scene that I describe in the book that I felt that I lived 1,000 times at the White House. The president had this penchant for surrounding the Resolute desk, not just with cabinet officials, but with their subordinates, and he would invite a great debate, whether we were talking about building a wall on the southern border of the United States, whether we're talking about getting tax cuts done or health care reform done. And from time to time, in frustration, as I wrote, he would occasionally kind of thunder from behind the desk and say, "Now, everybody, just got to get it done. Go, get out of here. You got to go get it done." And people would kind of fold up their papers and sheepishly walk out of the Oval Office, but leaving he and I alone. And almost invariably, he turned to me and say, "How was that?" You know,
and it is a wonderful anecdote.
Where General Patton bellows at the troops that they're going to march out in the morning, and if no one comes back alive, no one comes back alive. And his number two looked at him and said, "You know, General, sometimes the men don't know when you're acting and when you're not." And George C. Scott, as Patton says, "It's not important for them to know. It's only important for me to know." As I said,
it's perfect.
I felt like I lived that scene 1,000 times because we had a president who knew what he was there to do, and he knew when to bring people in, and he also knew when to send them out the door with urgency.
That is part of the interview with Vice President Pence that I did yesterday. All of it is at yesterday's podcast. I'll play a little bit more tomorrow. I want to congratulate Leader McCarthy on becoming Speaker Designate McCarthy, Steve Scalise on becoming Majority Leader Designate of the Republican Party, and Tom Emmers on becoming Whip Designate of the Republican Party. I'm looking forward to the Select Committee on China being announced and stood up very, very quickly so they can get to work and hire staff and get the very best staff, including a lot of Mandarin speakers, organize itself around educating the United States public about what the Chinese Communist Party is up to and doing it quickly. I want to remind you as well, relieffactor.com, already took it this morning. Heading out for my trundle. It is cleared. The rain has cleared. It's not coming down anymore in Northern Virginia, so I will be able to go out and trundle around a little bit. But I'll feel better doing it because I took my relief factor in the first hour, and I remind you to take it every single day at the end of the third segment of most hours. Sometimes I do it a little bit early when I want to take an interview long, as I did with former Vice President Pence about his book, So Help Me God. I really think you ought to go get that book, and I really think you ought to go get relieffactor.com. I also think you ought to download the Salem News Channel so you can see me hold up the relieffactor.com bag every day, and then you'll know what it looks like, and you'll know what to look for when it arrives in the mail, $19.95 for the 3-week starter pack. Do not get left behind. When we come back, I'm going to take a few more calls on what you thought about Donald Trump's speech last night. My phone number is 1-800-520-1234, 1-800-520-1234. Please hear me. If you didn't watch it, I don't want to talk to you. And, you know, normally I would, but I just want to know what people thought about that speech and whether it changed their mind about President Trump running again to be president as a former president. 1-800-520-1234. I'll be right back on this Wednesday edition of The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of The Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by PhD Weight Loss and Nutrition. Go to myphdweightloss.com to learn more.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Generalissimo, I gave him a comment and a call. You know, I complimented him extraordinarily in yesterday's interview with Mike Pence. I don't think he's recovered from that, but I want to check in on the MyPhDWeightLoss.com status report. Did you hear me give you, like, the big all props of all time?
No. Well, what I heard you say is you were calling for a cut that you never asked me for ahead of time.
I did. You just don't read your text. You're busy on the scales.
You oftentimes think that you asked me to do something and you never ended up doing
it. All right. I got to get to the caller, so I just want to know. MyPhDWeightLoss.com, which people can call at 864-644-1900. Let's do that again. 864-644-1900. Dwayne had lost 50 pounds. Then he gained back a half pound of it. And I don't want him to watch the scale because maintenance is about being a pound down or a pound up. How are you?
I'm back down to 190.8.
Boy, that 188 is really just tantalizingly close, isn't it?
I don't need 188.
I know you don't, but you'd like to get there so you could eat some fudge.
No. I am in my fudge. My fudge is between 190 and 195.
Yeah, but you want those Del Taco fries. I know you do. And that's a 188.
I can have them periodically. That's the beauty of this whole system.
Well, when you talk to Rachel this week, ask her about the Del Taco fries. I don't think she's going to allow that on the maintenance program.
Well, I'll fudge.
MyPhDWeightLoss.com. You got to spell the whole thing out. MyPhDWeightLoss.com or call 864-644-1900. He stepped on the phone number again. He's been in radio longer than I have. He's like 100 years longer than me. 864-644-1900.
Yes.
Thank you, Generalissimo. Okay. Let's back to the phones. Mark in Pennsylvania, what do you think of former President Trump's speech last night?
I watched just about the whole speech. I thought he set a very good tone. He was mellow. He was somewhat humble. He did not get into colorful, should we say, language. He was forward-looking. He stated his accomplishments. I think he probably, scared is probably the wrong word, a lot of his competition into rethinking their plans for 2024.
Thank you, sir. And I want Tony in Delaware next. Tony, what'd you think of the speech?
Yeah, well, from a guy growing up in the mean streets of the Bronx, okay, I would say Trump needs to just understand that he has a record, a good record, one of the best presidents to ever, you know, take office, and he needs to stop beating up on people and just run on his record. We don't need to hear him belittle anybody. Just run on your awesome record. And
what did you did the speech do that last night?
Well, he did kind of backtrack toward that. He did say something about 2020, but I was on the DeSantis train, and Trump can win my vote, you know, and my support. But he's just got to be a calm, measured leader, and not, you know, he's got to be mature.
All right, thank you, little kid. Greg in Florida, what'd you think, Greg? Hello, Greg, you're on. Greg is gone. Oh, go ahead.
Yes.
Yeah, you're on a delay, Greg. Come on, talk.
I'm waiting down, Greg.
Yeah, we can't hear you. All right, let's go to Russ. Russ, what do you think? Hello, Russ.
Hello?
Yeah, you're on, Russ.
Okay. I was leaning towards him not running, and having watched what he had to say, and that he didn't go into 2020, I feel much better that he should run. And the thing that strikes me the most right now is how unusually credible his position is for a politician when he can honestly say, I kept my promises, and concerning restoring the economy, he can honestly say...
Okay, I got it. So you liked it. I want to get one more in. Phil in California, what did you think, Phil?
I watched it. It was outstanding, but a week ago Tuesday I shifted to Ron DeSantis, and Mike Pompeo continues as my number two.
It didn't bring you back?
No, it did not.
Did it move you further away?
Pitch. No. It made me rather wistful, but there's kind of two sides to Trump, and I think it's time to move on.
And Phil, did you watch it with anyone, or did you watch it by yourself?
By myself, because okay. The fetching Mrs. Phil was at a corral practice.
Oh, okay. Oh, this is Phil. Hey, Phil, how are you?
That Phil, doing well, thanks.
I haven't talked to you in a long time.
It's been 20 years since we met.
Yeah, but I, you're up early in California. I appreciate the call, my friend. My best to everybody. Don't go anywhere, America, except to Mike Gallagher's show or whichever comes up next on this great radio station. And I will be back tomorrow with more analysis, more great guests, more important stuff. The Chris Christie audio and transcript will be posted shortly. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Thank you for listening. Thank you, Adam. Thank you, Jacob. Thank you, Generalissimo. Stay tuned.